Hi friends, I am Professor Dr. N. Chandrasekharan. Today's topic, Sale of Goods Act 1930, Part 2. In my Part 1 lecture, I have covered three conditions in the case of implied conditions. Let me continue with the fourth condition, that is condition as to quality or fitness. If the buyer makes known to the seller the particular purpose for which he buys the goods shall be reasonably fit for the very purpose for which he makes the purchase. For which I would like to explain with a case law. Priest versus Last, 1903, P asked for A hot water bottle to S, the retail chemist. He was supplied one which burst after few days use and injured P's wife. The court held that S was liable for the breach of implied condition. What's the meaning of this case? Here, he already made known to the seller the purpose for which he needs a particular product. If it does not fit, if it does not suit the purpose, he can reject the goods. Second case, if the buyer buying an article for a particular purpose is suffering from any abnormality not made known to the seller at the time of sale. This is very important. He is suffering from some problem. He might be suffering from any diabetic or blood pressure or anything like that, but he didn't make a note of it to the seller. In that case, implied condition of fitness does not apply. For example, X purchased a cough syrup from a medical shop owner, Mr. Y, without disclosing the fact that he is suffering from diabetic. After consuming the syrup, the situation gets aggravated. So a case was filed and judgment came that the seller is not liable. This is very important because the buyer has not made known to the seller the fact that he is a diabetic. So the implied condition of fitness does not apply. A third category, if the buyer buying an article under its patent or trademark, for example, when you are intend to buy a product, it may be a flask or umbrella or a cooker. In that case, if you insist the seller to supply a particular brand, particular product bears a particular trademark, in that case, implied condition does not apply. So you rely only on the brand name, only on the trademark, only on the patent. That's the meaning. Last category, if the goods can be used for a different purposes, the buyer must tell the seller the particular purpose for which he requires the goods. A product may be used for different purposes, but a buyer may need a product for a particular purpose only. In that case, he should reveal the purpose for which he makes the purchase. Otherwise, the condition of fitness shall not apply. Next condition, fourth one, under section 16, clause 2, implied condition as to merchantable quality. The seller who deals in goods, whether he is a manufacturer or not, that's immaterial. There is an implied condition that the goods shall be of merchantable quality. What's the meaning of merchantable quality? Must fit for the purpose for which we are making the purchase, we are using the product. Here also I have mentioned one famous British case law, Morelli versus Fitch and Gibbons, 1928. Here M asked for a bottle of Stone's ginger wine at S shop. While M was drawing the cork, the bottle broke and M was injured. It was held that M was entitled to recover damages as the bottle was not of merchantable quality. That means it should fit for the purpose. Fifth one, implied condition by custom, section 16, clause 3. The purpose of purchasing goods may be ascertained from the conduct of the parties to the sale. Here also I have mentioned one case law, Dr. Barito versus T.R. Price, 1939. Here, Mr. A bought a set of false teeth from a dentist. The set did not fit into his mouth. What's the purpose of buying a duplicate or false teeth? It should fit perfectly into the mouth. In that case, it does not suit. So it is held that X could reject the set and claim damages as the purpose for which anybody would buy it was implicitly known to the seller. Here, who is the seller? The dentist. Next case law, Grant versus Australian Knitting Mills Limited. In this case, Dr. Grant, the plaintiff, had bought an undergarment from a retailer. On usage, the buyer contracted with a disease that is called dermatitis. He sued the retailer and the manufacturer in tort and got relief. Sixth condition, implied condition as to sale by sample. This is under section 17. Here also I have mentioned one famous case law, Moody versus Gregson. In a contract for the sale of brandy, by some sample brandy colored with a dye was supplied. Even though the goods supplied were equal to the sample. So the goods supplied and the sample are equal. But the court held that the buyer was not bound to the contract. Why? The reason being, as the defects were not apparent on the reasonable examination of the sample. It's very, very difficult for the buyer to judge the product on reasonable examination of the product. Only on usage, it can be ascertained. Another case law, E&S Reuben Limited versus Fair Brothers, 1949. In this case, A bought some rubber material from B on the basis of the sample shown. On receiving the rubber material, A found that the measurement was different. Here the point is, the product is okay, but the measurement was different from that of the sample. So the court held that measurement was also a part of its quality. So quality means that includes the measurement also. So it was held that the goods did not correspond to the sample. So in that case, the buyer can repudiate the contract and claim damages. Seventh category, seventh condition, implied condition as to wholesomeness. Wholesomeness means it must be fit for the very purpose for which they are bought. Goods should be such as commercially saleable under the description. This is applicable in case of eatables and provisions. For which there is one case law, Frost versus Aylesbury Dairy Company Limited, 1905. Here, F purchased milk from A that contained typhoid germs. After consuming, F's wife got highly infected and as a result, she died. So a case was filed by Mr. A, and it was held that F could recover damages from the seller. So whatever may be the goods, whether it's a milk packet or paneer packet or biscuit packet, it should fit for the very purpose for which they are bought. This is called wholesomeness. Another case law also there is, Chapronier versus Smashen, 1905. Mr. C bought a bun containing a stone, which broke one of C's teeth. A case was filed, and it was held that C could recover damages. So, these are the seven important implied conditions. This is very, very important for the examination point of view of BCom, MCom, ACA, ACS, and other professional courses. Thank you so much for watching this video. Hope this will be of great useful to you. Stay watching. Thank you so much.